Welcome to our Crossing Archive. My name is Joey Harris, and I'm the online minister here at The Crossing. Here's where you can find all of our full services from our Crossing online experience. We're in our new series called Make It Count. This week, Jerry Harris, our senior pastor, is teaching us all about our core values. But before he preaches, we've got some incredible worship for you. Thanks for watching.
All right, church, get ready to put your hands together. Here we go.
Yeah. Crossing Church, Happy New Year! How you doing? So I said, Happy New Year. You got to say it back to me. Ready? Thank you. Appreciate that. Well, it is a Happy New Year for me because I'm a grandfather. Thank you very much. It's pretty exciting. Woo! Yeah, how many of you are in that club? Oh, yeah, I'm in the club. I got my card and everything, you know, right next to my FOIA card. Right? I'll carry my gun, have my... Anyway. Just kidding. Anyway, I want to welcome all of our campuses that are joining with us. We're so glad that we get an opportunity to minister to you. You get to minister to us online, inside, .tv. Just so excited about that. We've got a new .tv location meeting together in Jacksonville, Illinois. We want to welcome all of you. We're glad that you're coming in and we get to have that opportunity to connect with you. Last week, we had a great sermon. Clayton did a great job talking about making it count. And the key component of that is to get it in our heads that it's not about us. And that's actually a really good thing. And what it can accomplish in the kingdom is incredible. This is actually not quite that, but something monumental happened last fall in our home. We got high-speed internet for the first time. And the fiber came through, and we first time in our lives really got the opportunity to understand the wonderful world of Netflix. And now that it's the new year, I need to go to Celebrate Recovery because of Netflix. They can help me with that. It's pretty sick when my wife gets on social media and says, hey, what's a good series we haven't seen? And all of them that they're telling us, we've already seen. And it's like, oh, this is not good. We've been spending way too much time. That's why there's that indention on the couch. Whoo, that's a great New Year's resolution. I imagine some of you have made some of those resolutions as well, and that's good. But I want to tell you a real one, one that's very important to me, and it's going to sound a little odd, but it's this. I want to communicate better. Now, you're probably thinking, well, that's what you do. And I'm like, yeah, that's what I do, but I want to do it even better, because when I communicate, I have an opportunity to lift up others. And you know why that's a big deal? Because the fruit of my life, it grows on other people's trees. And when I lift up other people and they in turn lift up other people, that's a big deal. And I think there's that potential in all of us to be able to lead others and to have your fruit grow on their trees as well. And one of those things that I want to communicate best of all this year is our core values as a church. Now, if I were to ask you, what's our mission as a church? I think most of you could answer that question almost verbatim, because you've heard it nonstop for 18 years. You know what it is? That we help people find, that's exactly right, an intimate, personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I discovered that 24 years ago. It was before I ever came here. I was taking a class called Experiencing God, and it just rocked my world. It changed me. And this is how it changed me. There were a lot of people that were around me, and I had been a senior pastor for 10 years, but there were people around me that, they went to church and they did their religious thing, but I don't think that they really understood that. And I think in some areas of my life, I don't think I did either, that you could actually have a real, live, intimate, personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And when I came to Quincy, that was the main thing I wanted to share, the main thing I wanted to communicate, because I began to realize that people just didn't know that that kind of a relationship was even possible. And it was so much more than just going to church. And what was really incredible is I was able to watch God literally work miracles right in front of me in other people's lives as they began to realize the truth of that statement. How many things they went back to that were the right things and left that were the wrong things, and how much healing took place in that. I saw God unleash his power in it. I saw him do it in this community. Now, you know, you might hear that and go, well, you know, that's what he thinks. He's entitled to think that. Did it really do anything? Before we were in all these communities, when we were just in Quincy, did it do anything? Was it effective? Is there any proof of that? Well, this last year, I actually discovered a website, a demographic website called City Data. It's not a Christian site. It's just a website where you have exhaustive demographic information on every community in America. And so I typed in Quincy, Illinois. And as I was going down through that demographic study, there was one particular page that was all about religion. And I have to tell you, when I was looking at that, it was just transformative. It was amazing to see what God had done. And I want to share that graph with you today and explain it. This is just one little piece of a very large graph that talks about climate and everything else. And what I want, this is from 2000 to 2010. So other locations, You're going to see this from 2010 to 2020 when we have the 2020 census. But right now, you can only really see this as far as effectiveness in Quincy. The dark line is 2010, and the light blue line is 2000. So you're seeing the change between 2000 and 2010. Now, I want you to see, this one down here at the bottom is called none. It means these people did not claim any kind of religious affiliation of any kind. And in 2000, that number in Adams County, Illinois, was 22,569. 10 years later, the people that said, we don't have any religious affiliation, went from 22,569 to 14,839. Went down 8,000 people. Now watch this. This top line, this is the group we would be involved in. Evangelical Protestant. Evangelical means we share the good news, right? Okay, evangelical Protestant. And this is the number in 2000. 10,837 people in Adams County claimed that they were evangelical Protestants. In 2010, 26,498. Now, some people will say, oh, that was a lot of people transferring churches, right? Not so. Catholicism went down by less than 1,000, probably about 300, from 15,933 down just a little bit. Didn't really have a big impact on the Catholic community in Adams County. Had a little bit bigger impact on mainline Protestant, which would be like Lutheran, Presbyterian, Disciples of Christ, Congregational, 13,160 to 89,72. And I look back and I go, in 10 years, people that had no relationship with Jesus Christ went down 7,000 people, 8,000 people, excuse me, and people who claimed to have that relationship with Christ went up 16,000. And what that tells me is that God is doing a massive work. And we get to be a part of that massive work. And locations, I want you to know that when we see 2010 to 2020, you're going to see what he's doing in your community. And it's incredible, absolutely incredible. Not only does this graph show our influence, it also reflects our first core value. Remember, that's what I want to communicate with you. We know our mission. Let's understand our core values. The Crossing has seven of them. So I'm going to take the next 2 weeks to talk about it, right? This is what makes us us. If we want people to have that relationship with Jesus, this is how we feel that we're going to be able to get there, okay? Core value number one. Might want to write them down. Core value number one. Ready? It's outward. We will do whatever it takes to reach people who are far from Jesus. Amen? We will do whatever it takes to reach people who are far from Jesus. We are not a church that is about people faking it, like we've got it all together. We've learned in the last few years, and we've qualified it this way, that there's an upper story and there's a lower story, right? That we all exist in this lower story, the place where our lives happen, where the grind happens, where the circumstances and the challenges happen. But God has an upper story plan for our life that is an incredible plan. Right? Truth is, all of us struggle, and all of us at one time or another have been stuck down in that lower story. It's something that's common to all of us, right? And it's that place where you feel like you're alone, like you're unloved, like you're insignificant, like you're broken. But when you find Jesus and that relationship with him, you get your first glimpse of the upper story. Look at our worship. Look at the people that are around you at all of our locations. Look at the people that we hire on our church staff. Look at these great ministries we have, like Celebrate Recovery, like Crossing Inside, like our thrift stores, like our online services. All of our locations all spread out in these communities, none of which are growing. And you'll see this core value actually playing out. That we'll do whatever it takes to reach people who are far from God. It's right out of Jesus' playbook. Look at Matthew chapter 9, verses 36 to 38. This is Jesus. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. That's the lower story, people. They were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, and he's saying to us right now, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. And do you know what that resonates inside of me? I want to do whatever it takes to reach people who are far from God. Core value number one. If I want them to have an intimate personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I got to reach them. And they're going to be far from God. What's our core value number two? You ready to write another one down? It's downward. We said outward. Now we're saying downward. And we're talking about ages here, right? Here's the statement. We will gladly give up the things that we love. Gladly give up the things that we love to reach a future generation that we love even more. You hear that? We will gladly give up the things that we love to reach a future generation we love even more. We are living in an unparalleled time. We are living in a time, in all of the world, where five generations are existing at the same time, are living at the same time. Do you know that in 1900, the average life expectancy in America was 48? And now the average life expectancy is 78, and they just changed it to 82. So we have five full generations living on earth in America at the same time. Now, I'm going to identify those, and you're going to identify with them as I identify them, okay? The first one is the traditionalist generation. Those are people that were born before the end of World War II. And I was raised by parents who were traditionalists. My dad was born in 1910. My mother was born in 1917. So they knew what it was like to grow up in the Great Depression. They knew what it was like to go hungry at night. They knew what it was like to fold your tinfoil, wash it and fold it and put it and use it again. It's a different, whole different time in America, right? And this generation, defined as the greatest generation, by the way, the traditionalists, they were defined by loyalty, commitment, sacrifice, because being shaped by the circumstances of their time. And the church was a reflection of that generation at that time. You know what it looked like? It was denominational in nature. And let me tell you something, that was your team. And if you were born a Methodist, you were going to be a Methodist when they put you in the ground, because the cemetery was right behind the church. Right? If you were a Presbyterian, if you were whatever, that was your team. I mean, that was your, and it didn't matter if the youth group was any good. It didn't matter if the sermons were any good. That didn't have anything to do with it. A lot of times church was an exercise in intense boredom. But you did it because that was what you do. You brought your best, you dressed up, right? Suit and tie. And it was rote. And that's what you did. Well, those guys went to war. And they were working 12 and 14 hour shifts to supply the war. And a lot of their friends died. And they came back and they realized it's time to get busy living. And so they started having kids right away. And they had a lot of kids. And that generation was called the baby boomer generation. It was a boom of babies being born, right? And this was a completely different generation. They defined for their children what they wanted. They wanted them to achieve greater things than they ever had. They wanted to have more of an education. They wanted them to make more money. They wanted them to live in a bigger house. They wanted them to be optimistic. They wanted them to be individualistic, which caused them to become materialistic. And the church, once again, reflected that. For the first time, we started recognizing subcultures like youth group. Didn't exist before. Kids had to stay in church and be quiet or they got hit. Right? But now we had these alternatives these countercultural things that were happening. For the first time, we had mega church. I remember growing up, there was no church in Indianapolis beyond 600 people. All of a sudden, mega church. Now we have play places in our church. We have coffee houses in our church. We have all sorts of different things that wouldn't even have been dreamed of back then, right? We wanted good music because we loved music and we loved rock music, but we knew that there were a lot of bad things in rock music, so we created our own genre of music, contemporary Christian music, which we sing and play even today, right? We said, these suits and ties are crazy. So we wore comfortable clothes, and we said, pews don't feel comfortable, so we got nice cushy chairs. Why? Well, because we knew we could achieve. We were optimistic. We were individualistic. We were consumers. I'm a baby boomer. I understand this. And then we had children. And the earliest of us had children. That generation was called Generation X. Generation X, a completely different generation. It's only 15 years long instead of 20 years long. Part of the reason is because baby boomers didn't have a lot of kids. You know why they didn't? Because they wanted money and stuff, and too many kids are too expensive, and so we're going to have less kids. They were more concerned about achieving things. And in that generation, a lot of bad things happened. Vietnam War happened. Divorce rate quadrupled in that generation. People quit trusting institutions like the government. Why? Because of Watergate. Like school, public school. And so you see that give way to more parochial school involvement and especially homeschool. People got rid of the idea of free love because AIDS happened. And people quit trusting the church because of all the televangelist debacles. The church reflected that. We developed small groups. We became more downwardly mobile because Generation X was more concerned about family than they were about achievement because they grew up in broken homes. They started to leave the church because they didn't think that it was relevant anymore and pursued more missional living and social justice. The youngest Generation Xers are now 36 years old. They're 36 to 50. If you're over 50, you're a baby boomer, unless you're over 70, and then you're in the traditionalist generation. Now, because Generation X loved their families, they had more kids, which is called the echo boom, by the way. It's actually bigger than the baby boom. There are going to be more millennials than there were baby boomers by far. And the millennial generation is 15 years old to 35 years old. Now, our second core value is we will give up the things that we love to reach a future generation that we love even more. And that future generation, they're the millennials. Let me describe the millennials to you. This is a world where the smartphone is not optional. There was actually a study that was done, and some millennials said they would give up their sense of smell before they gave up their smartphone. I know you don't believe that, but you're probably not millennial. This is a generation that doesn't carry cash. They don't use a checkbook. They marry 7 to 10 years later than the generations before them. They live over 10 years longer than the generation that was before them. They are connected more in every way and yet isolated more than all of the generations before them. They struggle in social interaction even though they're more socially connected than any generation before. Let me just show you how disconnected you are from millennials, unless you're a millennial. Last year, how many of you saw the 2016 Super Bowl or know of people that were watching it? If you didn't know there was a Super Bowl, and a lot of people, you didn't raise hands, like, what? I'm going to start lifting some rocks. Anyway, 114 million people worldwide watched the Super Bowl, right? How many of you have heard of the video game League of Legends? How many of you have heard of Twitch TV? Like 9. Last year, League of Legends World Championship on Twitch TV attracted 396 million people. Almost four times the Super Bowl. And you haven't even heard of it. Are we disconnected from that generation? Is it important that we connect with that generation? What's it teaching us? Every generation is different. Some of the stuff I said you really connect with, right? Some of it you don't. Here's the deal. In the church, the message never changes. It is always the same. But the methods in which we connect with the generation have to always constantly change. The delivery system can't remain the same. Why? Because we are tasked to make it count. We must change for this core value to become a reality. So we have got to become a church that's a laboratory, that's experimental, with online, with worship, with integration, with texting to give, with smartphones as a key component in worship. Instead of telling people to silence their phone and put it away, we need to start telling them to get it out and use it during the service. What? We need to learn how to ask more questions instead of making statements. We need to do more listening than talking. Why? Jesus said it in Matthew chapter 7, verses 9 to 11. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? Why is this core value important? Because they're important. Because I will gladly give up things I love to reach a future generation that I love even more. Bottom line. Core value number three, relevance. We will do fresh things in fresh ways to reach those no one else is reaching. Over the holidays, I had the opportunity to have my daughter, Abby, home, my youngest daughter. They're all millennials. All my kids are millennials. And I had an opportunity to talk to her a little bit about it. And I was bragging on some video that we were doing. A couple of things in particular. One video has to do with worship. And those of you that are watching online, this is going to be your worship in the second part of the service. And it's basically millennial in nature. I'm going to show you a clip of that. And we also did a thing with Journey to Bethlehem and connected that to our Christmas Day services. We had 17 of those services. I want you to watch these videos with me quickly, and I'll talk about it as they go. It's a little different than what you see on stage, isn't it? But this is millennial worship. And I was in this room, and I would have joined that church. It was great. This is what our online people are experiencing. This is part of the 17 services we had on Christmas. And some people were frustrated, even angry, that we didn't have services on Christmas Day at church, that we had them on Thursday and Saturday. But this is what happened. We had 6,000 people watch that service over those 17 hours, 6,000 people. And a lot of those people were in homes, and there were family members that wouldn't have gone to church otherwise. So what were we trying to do? We were trying to be able to convey the message of Jesus. And that's what this is. Jesus was born. He died on a cross. That is what I was talking about there. And then they took communion together in homes. Did we forget that in the book of Acts, they didn't just meet in the temple courts? They met from house to house. And yet, for some reason, we get so institutionalized that we forget what's actually happening. Well, my daughter then pulled up some other projects that we had done over that year. And I look back at last year and I loved it. We did some really relevant, innovative things, like Easter. We got a lot of heat for that because we did this thing on Emerson Switch. I don't know if you remember that. And then we talked about being difference makers. I want to show you, and this is kind of a greatest hits of last year. And if one of these really impacted you, would you just like show your approval of that by clapping, okay? I can't hear everybody, but I can hear you guys. Let's watch this one. We actually had churches that said that said bad things about us on their church signs because we did this. This is difference maker. We want everybody to be a difference maker. Building the church brick by brick. You remember, guys, you remember this? Sons of Thunder. This is going to get the big applause right here. When we did the Heroes series, it's because my wife preached anyway. And then you can't have a hero without a sidekick. We talked about the person behind the leader. Some great, great teaching in that. Then we talked about the kind of world we live in, that we're living up in an upside down world, trying to live right side up, thriving in Babylon. And this one kind of got us all. We learned how to pray the way the Bible taught us how to pray. We just got done with a series that I thought was fun because it was based in the movies, and you can't go wrong with The Godfather, right? Anyway, if you do, you'll be sorry for it. We called that prequel. What we understood was Jesus in the Old Testament through that. Why do I bring all that up? Well, because it shows that our desire, our heart's desire as a church, is to present fresh things in fresh ways to reach people that nobody else is reaching. Is it working? Our stat on baptism, the end of 2016, we had 900 baptisms last year. The year before that, we had 1,011. The year before that, we had 881. And the year before that, we had 970. God's doing incredible, incredible things. We saw what happened on Christmas as 6,000 people participated online in our service. We have 1,500 to 2,000 every week and another 3,000 every weekend live and another 3,000 or so during the week that participate in our services. Why? Because we will do fresh things in fresh ways to reach people no one else is reaching. Look what it says in the book of Psalms 78. He commanded our forefathers to teach their children so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. Do you see how these core values work together to try to make that happen? That's our heart. Our heart, and next week we're going to hear the other four, the seven core values of our church. I want to effectively communicate that to you so that you can effectively communicate that to the world outside of all of our walls. I don't want you to miss them. These are the values that make us who we are. Some of you have an intimate personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Many of you do, and I'm so thankful for that, but there are people sitting around you right now that don't have that relationship. And I want you to know, we exist for you. We want to be there for you. And if you do have an intimate personal relationship with Jesus, we invite you to embrace these values along with us and just take it out to the world and see God change the world through us. Why? Because we want to make it count in 2017. Now I'm going to, this comes the best part of the whole sermon. Ready? This is Ainsley Kay. She's obviously listening to one of my sermons. I have this effect. I'm just kidding. I have this effect on people. I show you that picture because this. I'm not going to be the one that reaches her. She's part of the generation that's coming after the millennial generation. And I have to do my due diligence to raise up a generation that's going to reach my granddaughter. Are you hearing me? Are you feeling that? You have daughters and sons. You have granddaughters and grandsons. You have great-granddaughters and great-grandsons. Listen to me. We will do whatever it takes to reach people who are far from God. And we will gladly give up the things we love to reach a future generation that we love even more. And we will do fresh things in fresh ways to reach people that nobody else is reaching because the stakes are that high. They're that high. And I want you to be committed along with me to understand and live by these values that can change our world, that have changed our world, right where we live. We're moving to a time of decision.
Core values are great to know for you that attend our church on a regular basis. It lets you know how and why we make the decisions that we make. If you see something you don't like or you don't understand why something has changed, these core values are the key to understanding. Each core value is like a filter. When you have an idea, does it pass through that filter? Is it outward and downward and relevant? But it's not just for the church, it's for you. Do you live your life outward? Will you do whatever it takes to reach people for Jesus? Or have you been living your life in your own world, living it for you on your own terms? That's something to bring to Jesus right now. He wants a relationship with you so he can work with you to have even more relationships with more people. He loves you, but he also loves everyone else, and he needs you to reach those people with him. Is your faith downward? This is for the Gen Xers and the baby boomers watching. Do you live a life where you would gladly give up the things you love to reach a future generation you love even more? Are you so attached to the way things were that you fail to see the way things are, and it stops you from reaching the next generation? Bring it to the cross. It's a hard ask to give up everything you grew up with so you can connect with someone who didn't grow up with the way you did. As a millennial, I can tell you, we need you. We need your wisdom, your guidance, and your life experiences. What we don't need is how things were. What we need is how to learn from your story, to learn from your example, and how to apply that to how things are in our lives. That's what Jesus needs from you right now. Will you take the leap of faith and give it all up to him? Right now, you have time to truly examine your hearts, to give it all up to God right now and start reaching people you would have never thought you could have. If you're willing, God will use you for his greater purpose to reach the generations yet to come and make this world not just a better place, but a Christ-centered place. Let your legacy not be what you've done in this world, but who you have impacted for Jesus. Let's spend some time with him right now.
You've turned my sadness into
The last core value Jerry talked about was being relevant. One of the best ways to be relevant to the millennial generation is to be honest, truly honest with yourself. We have grown up in a world where there is no such thing as absolute truth. But as a Christian, I know this: Jesus loves you. He truly, honestly, deeply loves you. He loves you so much that he died on a cross to pay a debt that you and I owed so that we could have a chance at a relationship with him. That is what honest love looks like. Every week, we take a piece of bread and a cup of juice, which represents his body and his blood, and we take it in remembrance of his sacrifice. Jesus knew he wasn't going to be on this earth forever, so he raised up the next generation, his disciples, and told them to always know that he was with him in this time of communion. That same gift, that same promise, hasn't changed generation after generation. So together, let's be relevant. Let's spend time in communion, whether you have a piece of bread and a cup of juice or not, and spend time being the honest person with yourself and see where you stand with Jesus and how we need to change to grow deeper and more intimate in our relationship with him. Let's go to him right now. Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed our service. You can join us live at thecrossing.tv on Thursdays at 6 p.m. and Sundays at 9 a.m. and 10:45 a.m. all in the Central Time Zone. If you have any questions, you can always contact me at joeyh@thecrossing.net. Once again, thanks for watching.